Hi all and welcome. We're going to give folks just a couple minutes to continue joining and then we will get started. And welcome to those who are joining. We're just giving folks a few more minutes to get into the webinar and then we will get started. Hi, Jerry. Good to see your comment. All right, well, it looks like folks have had a chance to join, so we will go ahead and get started. I just wanna say thank you to NIRS for the invite to moderate this panel today. My name is Bailey Childers and I'm the Director of Federal Government Affairs for AFSCME. We've got a great panel lined up for you today and we're going to discuss broad challenges and trends impacting retirement. And you know, as I'm sure you can all imagine, COVID-19, the pandemic and its associated economic impacts have impacted people in even in different ways. And so our panelists will touch on some of that as well. How we'll structure the panel today, each panelist is gonna give opening remarks and then we will open it up to questions. I have a lot on this topic, but please feel free to put your questions in the chat. And that's on the interface that you came in through, not in the Zoom chat. So please put your questions there as we go along. That way I can ask the panelists, those when we get to question and answer. I'm gonna do a quick introduction of each of the panelists. I won't read full bios because I believe if you click on their speaker profiles, you can see that, but I'll do a short intro. Each of these folks are far more qualified and have lots more credentials than what I'm gonna read off. So it's a great group of folks we're gonna hear from today. So I'll start with Ana Hernandez-Kent is a senior researcher for the Institute for Economic Equity at the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. She conducts research, performs data analysis, and advises on issues of economic equity. She received a PhD in experimental psychology with concentrations in social psychology and quantitative methods and behavioral sciences from St. Louis University. Kate Bond is the director of labor market policy and an economist at the Washington Center for Equitable Growth. Her areas of research include gender, race, and ethnicity in the labor market and care work. And she received her PhD in economics from the New School for Social Research. And then finally, Nari Ree is the director of retirement security program at the UC Berkeley Labor Center. Her current research focuses on the retirement crisis facing California and the US in the context of declining pension coverage and policies to improve the retirement income prospects of low and middle wage workers. And she earned her PhD in geography from UC Berkeley. So with that, let me turn it over to Ana to get us started.
Thank you. Let me share my screen really quickly. Okay, so I am, as Bailey said in the intro, I'm not an economist. I'm also not specifically a researcher on retirement. But what we do at the Institute for Economic Equity is mainly focus on wealth. Of course, retirement savings are a big component of that. So I'm going to be talking more broadly about wealth, but also what's happened before and also since the COVID-19 recession. These are my own views and not those of the view of the Fed or the Fed system. So broadly, this is not a general audience, right? I'm glad to be here. Thank you, NIRS, for putting this on. So I'm not going to, you know, take too much time to talk about what wealth is, but basically we focus on all assets minus all liabilities that we have access to. In terms of retirement savings, that includes defined contribution plans, not defined benefits in the data set that we primarily use. So I wanted to start with an overview of wealth inequality in the US. Sometimes I know we can get really focused on our niche areas and maybe don't necessarily have a broader view. So I wanted to begin with that. As of 2019, the top 10% of families grouped by wealth had about 3/4 of total family wealth in the US, whereas the bottom half of American families, roughly 64 million families, owned about 1% of that wealth. And really importantly here, like this is usually a pretty shocking statistic to people I present to, and they really tend to focus in on these differences. But I want to make it clear that who is in these different groups isn't randomly assigned. So people in and families in the bottom 50% tend to be younger, tend to be Black or Hispanic, tend to be less educated, and tend to be women-led. So again, it's not just by random chance that families fall into the bottom or the top of these groups. So what I'm going to be focusing on today is primarily race and ethnicity with a little bit of generational wealth sprinkled in. So turning first to Black family wealth, as well as the Black-white racial wealth gap, which has been in the news a lot recently, given many of the past year's events. What we see on the left is a figure of what wealth at the median, so for the typical family at right at the middle, the 50th percentile, what that's looked like over a 30-year period. And essentially, what you can get from this is that it's fluctuated a little bit. The top line is white median wealth, the bottom line is Black median wealth. But overall, that gap has remained more akin to a chasm, and it's been fairly consistent over time. So as of 2019, Black families had just 12 cents in median wealth per every dollar of wealth that white families had. And if you look at basically any part of the balance sheet, you'll find similar gaps. There's gaps in the asset side as well as the debt side. In terms of retirement savings, we see that just 35% of Black families had anything in retirement savings, even just a dollar in defined contribution plans, versus over half of white families. And if you look within those families too, there are big differences. So for those families that did own some retirement savings, white families had a median balance of about 80,000 versus about 32,000 for Black families. If you look at Hispanics versus whites, it's essentially the same picture as for Blacks versus whites. Over time, the gap is a little bit smaller in 2019. And in large part, that's because Hispanic family wealth grew pretty massively between 2016 and 2019 by 60%. Of course, 60% growth when you have pretty low levels of wealth to begin with translates into small actual gains, but still something to be celebrated. So Hispanic families had 21 cents compared to Black families owning 12 cents per dollar of white wealth. However, when we turn to retirement savings, in part because Hispanic families are younger than white families on average, Hispanic families had similar levels to Black families in terms of those who actually had retirement savings, and also exact conditional median value. So they had about $32,000 in retirement savings for those that had retirement savings compared to whites, 80,000. And I'll also add that these little dots here are basically the share of Hispanic or on the previous slide, Black families who had less, the share of families who had less than the median or typical white family. Me. Pull up the laser pointer. So it's these dots right here. And you can see that that share has stayed fairly consistent over time. So the majority of both Black and white, Black and Hispanic families had less than the typical white family in terms of wealth. So when we layer on a generational perspective, what we can see here, first of all, from this top graph is that racial differences emerge and are consistent across these different generations. So this is the share of families with retirement savings. And what really stood out to me was that you don't see generational differences necessarily. What's really coming through here is racial and ethnic differences. So regardless of whether you're looking at boomers or Gen Xers or millennials, white families have more and fairly similar across generations. Tend to have retirement savings compared to minority families. Where you do see generational differences is when you turn to the second figure. And that kind of makes sense, right? As you get older, you have more time to accumulate assets, pay down debts. your wealth, and also retirement savings tends to increase as people turn more towards saving in these kinds of vehicles. But you still see racial and ethnic differences. So white families, their conditional retirement balance tends to be higher than Black and Hispanic families within generation. So all of this that I just presented was based on the Survey of Consumer Finances, which comes out every 3 years. Most recently, the data is from 2019. In other words, it's pre-COVID. So what's happened since then, as my co-panelists Nari and Kate will talk about as well, I'm sure, is a little bit different, right? And the main thing that I want you to pull from my presentation is that those families that I already presented as being vulnerable prior to the pandemic are the ones that have been disproportionately negatively affected since then. And that's a theme that is very clear across many different data sets and many different resources. So those who had fewer assets to fall back on, lower wages, jobs that were more precarious, as Nari will talk about as well. I'm sure those are in harder hit industries. They tend to lack benefits. They're the ones that are being, you know, having higher job losses, having reduced work hours, et cetera, being put into positions where they have to make more difficult choices. In the case of women, for example, disproportionately having care responsibilities at home and having to either balance care with working remotely, or, you know, being faced with the difficult decision, do I care for my child or someone older, or do I face going into work? So many difficult choices that people across the spectrum are facing, but disproportionately those that are from more vulnerable families. So the final main slide that I want to discuss is let's narrow in a little bit, obviously, on retirement. So the first two points come from July 2020 Survey of Household Economics and Decision Making. And what it says here, the first one, is that about a third of Americans who are unemployed would handle a $400 emergency expense with cash. So in other words, the vast majority either would be completely unable to pay for this relatively small expense, emergency expense, which could come from needing a car repair or having a health crisis, which clearly COVID-19 is first and foremost a health crisis. Or they would have to borrow money either from a bank or from family members, friends, et cetera. Contrast that with the 76% of employed Americans in July who would have been able to pay for this with cash. So there is clearly a critical difference between those who are employed and unemployed, as you might expect. But again, just as with that first pie figure, the people that tend to be unemployed, that wasn't randomly distributed in this crisis, you know, was those vulnerable groups, Black Americans, Hispanic Americans, less educated Americans, women, et cetera, that were disproportionately affected. The second point here is that 9% of non-retired Americans cashed out or borrowed from their retirement accounts. And there are racial ethnic differences here where Blacks were more than twice as likely as whites. The interesting thing here is this is from July 2020, and the numbers are actually pretty similar to the survey when it was fielded back in 2019. So what this tells me is that there hasn't been, at least in this particular measure, a significant looking change because of the COVID-19 recession, at least as of July 2020. And from other researchers, it appears that part of that is just the unprecedented amount of aid that was given by the government. So that's a positive thing, even though we still see these racial and ethnic differences. And finally, from the Census Bureau's Household Pulse Survey, we see that in March of 2021, a little less than a third of adults said it was somewhat or very difficult to pay for just normal household expenses. And what that means is that retirement is probably not top of mind for these people. They're probably focused on just surviving the now. And I bring that up because the pandemic is still very much ongoing for these vulnerable families. In the news now, you'll see things like, you know, the U.S. is really recovering and we're doing really well. And certainly if you look at average statistics, there is a lot of positivity there. But I think, you know, you oftentimes have to take averages with a grain of salt because they, in terms of wealth at least, are more representative of families that are better off just because of how wealth is unevenly distributed in the country. So with that, I'm happy to answer questions in Q&A, and I will turn it over to Kate.
Thank you so much. Okay, I'll go ahead and share my screen. Great. So I'm going to start by talking about sort of what is going on in the labor market right now. So I know this conference is focusing on retirement security, but my perspective here is that what's going on in the labor market now not only impacts incomes now, but it can have really long-term effects on income, which of course will affect ability of people to save for retirement. And then it also has broader impacts for the overall health of the economy. To have a decline now and a decline in the economy that has affected particular groups of workers is bad for the overall health of the American economy. And so, you know, as Anna said, that there's been a pretty good generous relief that has taken place so far, but we really need to sustain that relief through the crisis so that when we get to the other end of the public health crisis, the economy can be sort of resilient as we fully try to get back up to speed. So broadly, the recent labor market data has showed that the labor market recovery is...
Sorry to interrupt. We can't see your slides if you have put them up.
Yeah, okay, let me try again. Does that work?
No.
Okay. Thank you for flagging that. Let me try to share my screen again.
Okay.
Great. How about now?
Yes.
Great. Okay. Yes. This is all you. This is the only slide you missed so far. So I think that that is okay. It's just my name. But so I'll just dig into some sort of the recent labor market data that's showing how the recovery has really followed the public health crisis, but there are still really significant disparities by gender, race, and ethnicity that could shape who gains from the recovery and could affect long-term economic growth and stability. So here's just some you know, recent labor market data. This is from the past 2 months. I think these might be from February, so not reflecting the most recent Bureau of Labor Statistics jobs report, but the 1 month prior to that. And here we can see on one side, the different sectors that have been impacted year over year. And you can see it is really hugely driven by leisure and hospitality has had a huge decline. These are jobs where we know that workers of color and women are overrepresented. And they're also jobs that tend to be low paid jobs. So it's really hard for these workers to sustain, to sort of weather the storm without having sufficient relief. This sector is coming back. Last month had a huge job gains in this sector. 280,000 jobs were added in leisure and hospitality alone, but the industry is still down over 3.1 million from where it was 1 year ago. And then the other sort of breakdown I think is really important to look at too, is looking at how this has affected public sector employment. So public sector employment tends to be sort of more of a lagging industry in recessions. It tends to have a downturn later in the recession or even sort of lag as the recovery begins. So you can see here that of course, there was huge steep declines in both the public and private sector, but there's been a much more tepid recovery in the public sector. Again, it was a little bit better last month compared to this February data. And that's partly because the relief that was passed did help state and local governments be able to maintain some employment. The reopening of schools helped teachers go back to work, but is still declining. And without, again, like targeted relief to state and local governments, there's a big risk for public sector employment to not grow back to the level it used to be at. And this again is also really important for women workers and Black workers because public sector employment has historically been a source of really good jobs for these workers. So both well-paid jobs and jobs with access to more retirement security. And so when we're looking across what's happened year over year to which groups of workers have lost the most jobs, a lot of what I'm focusing on is not only just women workers here, but the intersection of gender and race here. So you can see it's really stark how Latino women and Black women have lost huge proportions of jobs year over year. 8%, over 8% of Latino women have lost their job year over year, and 10% of Black women. And these are not just temporary income losses for workers. Losing a job really has sustained long-term impacts on your income growth. So I compare it to what happened in the Great Recession, which was a recession that really hit younger workers more. It hit millennials. And so millennials both took the longest to get back to higher levels of employment, and then even that much longer to get back to a regular path of income growth. And so I'm sort of predicting that unless we have huge effort to get these workers back to work and sustain their incomes through job loss, we'll see some of the same effects that these workers will just be on a lower
income growth trajectory for, you know, potentially up to 10 years for the rest of their life, which would be, you know, a huge negative impact on their ability to save for retirement. And as, you know, workers have lost income, it is which workers are losing income matters a whole lot. So here we see that workers who are lower income also are the ones who are more likely to lose income. Likewise, Latinx and Black workers were more likely to lose income. Asian American workers were also more likely to lose income. And then workers with lower levels of education were also more likely to lose income. And I think Anna said the same stat from the same survey, but I will just re-emphasize this, that the people who are facing these job losses, facing these declines in income, are also gonna have a harder time paying for household expenses. So that would mean, again, they can't save for retirement. I think that was the point that Anna made. And then looking at this, we see it is particularly Black women have had the hardest time finding, you know, being able to make those expenses, followed by Black men, then Latino women, then Latino men. So this is really, really impacting workers of color. It's really, really impacting women. Now, and I think an important point to keep in mind when we're looking at the intersection of both gender and race is that what has been unique about this crisis is really the care crisis, that workers are trying to figure out how to care for their families at a time where there's a huge increase to care needs, while they're also trying to sustain their families economically. And it is I don't want to diminish folks who are trying to operate homeschools while they're working remotely. I know that is an absolutely impossible task, but if you are a worker who is more likely to work in jobs that are in the service sector that have to be done in person, and you are not able to work remotely, you are really in between an absolute rock and a hard place, that if you cannot go to work in your unsafe job also while taking care of kids at home. And so I think this really explains some of these facts we're seeing, that it is really Black and Latinx women who are losing the most jobs because they can't both care for their families and do jobs that don't allow them to work remotely. And then the final point I'll make is that this is really important for the economic health of our economy more broadly. Research shows how consumption impacts of recessions for low-income workers. So low-income workers have to reduce their consumption so much more during recessions because they rely so much on their, you know, regular pay to sustain their consumption. This actually has an effect of amplifying recessions. So recessions can get worse because the workers that are hit the hardest with income losses are also exactly the same workers who do a lot of spending the economy and help sustain economic growth. The differences in how recessions hit workers by income level can amplify recessions. So we really need targeted income support as a sort of critical tool for alleviating some of these downside impacts of the recession across the economy. There has been a lot of really great relief already passed by Congress, but I think what we really need to focus on is just sustaining that until the crisis is over. And then also, we don't necessarily want to go just back to where we were prior to the crisis, because a lot of these disparities by gender and race existed prior to the crisis. We want to make sure that these workers who have faced the most disadvantages, who are likely to face the longest term consequences of the recession, are getting support until they are like truly on stable footing, so that their families can thrive. And those are the conditions I think that are sort of underlying this entire context of how people can save for retirement and sort of what type of lifelong economic stability they have. All right, thank you.
Great, so I'm gonna share my screen. All right, is that showing up okay? Okay, terrific.
Yes.
So good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are. And I'm also glad to be back at NIRS, where I started off my career years ago working on retirement issues. Today I'm gonna be talking about the gig economy and beyond that, precarious work, kind of leading into and through the COVID pandemic. So I think I just want to put a couple of sort of things to think about, which is that we have a way of thinking about gig as if it's something completely new, and if it's completely technology driven. When really these issues around whether it's Uber or misclassified janitors who are being paid as independent contractors when they should be employees, These all sort of lie at the intersection of the competitive practices of firms, right, and industries, and also social regulations around, right, who is considered a worker, and also what kinds of work are deserving of things like benefits, right, and decent wages or not. And you know, whether there's labor law enforcement, right? So it's really not just about technology and robots taking over. This is really about corporate practices plus, you know, government regulations. So I want to take this like way back, right? So there are these historically marginalized, underregulated sectors that have always had precarious work, right? Like domestic work, and also, you know, sectors like agriculture and construction. And a lot of sectors where there tended to be, you know, sort of casual laborers, right, who were often back in the 1930s, like Black workers, right, as well as like Mexican workers in the US. And so in the formation of the New Deal, when we came down with like key regulations like the Fair Labor Standards Act, right, and the National Labor Relations Act, certain sectors, right, in certain regions and certain populations were just cut out, right, of that labor accord. And so we've had these sectors historically that have been exempt from key labor regulations, or labor law enforcement was just lax. And then you basically had low wages and sort of low rates of access to employer benefits, or you didn't get any benefits at all. So this then gets layered over time, right? Because on top of that, we have industry restructuring, and sort of and an orientation towards flexibility, right? That starts in the 1980s and accelerates going forward. And so even the jobs that used to be kind of part of these central firms that actually had decent wages and benefits were often unionized, started to get shed, right? And then there's also economic restructuring, in that we have the loss of manufacturing and the rise of the service sector, right? Where wages and benefits tend to be lower. And the main thing is that firms have a strategy of shedding costs and risks through things like increased use of part-time workers, temporary workers, contract workers. And also even for workers that, you know, that ostensibly are W-2 employees, firms are using layers of subcontracting to insulate the firm from these costs. So a classic example is what happened to janitors in Silicon Valley, which is that, they used to be employed directly by these big office park owners or the big tech companies, right, that own these buildings. And then they started getting shed, right? The jobs started to get subcontracted out through these building services subcontractors that lowered their wages and benefits. And then in turn, they often would subcontract to even smaller business owners who would then pay a lot of these workers as independent contractors, even though under the law they should have been employees. So you see this basically this downward trend in wages from what used to be a living wage job to, you know, a poverty wage job. And a lot of the labor struggles that have happened really since the 90s has been about holding these firms accountable, right? Going back to Apple and say, hey, your janitors in your Apple buildings need to be paid better, right? Can you please pay your contractors more so that they can do that? Oops. And then finally, the latest iteration that we have is platform-based gig work. And so now there's this regulatory battle, right? And this very politicized battle that's been happening in the US, and it's happening in other countries as well, where, you know, in the case of California, the courts and the legislature said, well, we're going to implement a standardized, very simple test to see whether these are really independent contractors, these drivers, right? And they concluded they're not. They should really get the unemployment benefits, right? They should get the health benefits. They should be subject to the state's minimum wage, which is ramping up to $15, right, pretty soon. And, you know, unemployment benefits. Then Uber and Lyft spent a lot of money, right, on a ballot initiative to override the court decision, override the statute. So that's an ongoing battle. So I want to sort of put some context, perspective on the scope of precarious work. So I've heard crazy estimates like 50% of the, you know, of jobs are going to be gig jobs, you know, in the next 10 years. That's a little bit overblown. I think that what's more accurate is to say it's a significant and growing sector of the economy. So there's a study of alternative work arrangements, which is basically, you know, precarious, different forms of precarious work, independent contracting, on-call workers, temp agency workers, and labor contractors, right? Who might be providing labor to farms or to hospitals, right? Or to hotels, right? It really runs across industries. And all those forms of employment, sort of contingent employment, have grown. And it's across the income spectrum. For independent contractors, it skews towards higher income. If you find a lower paid independent contractor, there's a really good chance that they've been misclassified, that legally they really should be W-2 employees under current standards. And that basically, that the overall size of that workforce has grown, the share of the economy has grown from 10% to about 15-16%, right? So it's grown by more than 50% in 10 years between 2005 and 2015 when this study was conducted. So precarious employment contributes to both financial and health vulnerabilities. So one is income volatility is a big issue, which is feast or famine. And then you either don't have access to benefits, or they're inferior, or they're very costly. So paid sick leave, health insurance, and of course, having a retirement plan. And then you also have incomplete social insurance coverage, which means that even though as if you're self-employed, ostensibly you should be paying into Social Security and accumulating those benefits, there is really just a high degree of underreporting and undercontributing, especially for lower earning workers who are self-employed. And then there are also low rates of opt-in, if that's allowed in your state, to the unemployment insurance system and the short-term disability insurance programs run by states, family leave. And then there are eligibility issues for undocumented workers who might be paying into the programs like Social Security and unemployment insurance, but they're not eligible to collect the benefits. And that got to be a huge issue during the last year over the course of the pandemic, because they didn't get any of the supercharged unemployment benefits, they didn't get the stimulus payments, and it's very hard for states to come up with the money to be able to fill that gap. And so the result is that coming into the pandemic, these workers, for the most part, were very vulnerable to both health and financial shocks, right? And even, you know, even to minor shocks that would have been manageable, right? If you had the full range of benefits, if you don't have them, right, become very hard to manage. So here's just sort of a snippet of the impact of COVID-19 on gig workers in California. This is a survey that was done by UCLA that was focused primarily on rideshare, Uber, Lyft drivers. And the main thing is that, you know, 8 out of 10 said that they couldn't cover their household expenses with their current pay. They weren't really getting needed protective equipment to do their jobs from the platforms. What's interesting about this sample is that 3/4 said that the gig work was their primary income. So I think a reason for a lot of the large numbers you see on gig work has to do with the fact that for a lot of people, they might come in and try it for a few weeks and leave, right? There's high turnover, or they might be supplementing. I met a rideshare driver who was a teacher, right? K-12 teacher who was supplementing their pay through, rideshare. And so this is really looking at the population for whom gig work is a primary source of income. And so half of them, 7 out of 10 said that the COVID pandemic had reduced their hours, and half of them said that they had to stop working because of the pandemic. So obviously these are like really huge financial impacts on a population that is disproportionately workers of color. So I think one of the encouraging things about the pandemic in terms of government policy is government stepping up and saying, oh my gosh, we really need to take care of everybody because of the nature of this crisis. And so the addition of the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance Program was a really big deal, right? Because it gave unemployment benefits to workers who otherwise just would not have had anything because they were not in that W-2 employee relationship. And so I think the question is going forward, how long does this last? So I want to sort of skip to some of the policy choices that I think we face, related to precarious employment in the context of the recovery from the pandemic. So one is this whole issue of labor standards for gig workers and other forms of precarious employment. So it's a very politicized issue. And then there's this ongoing enforcement issue in that misclassification of employees as independent contractors it's a really big problem. And what tends to happen is that if you don't enforce it at the level of an industry, then basically the bottom feeders kind of set the standards, right? Because in order to compete, other firms have to start doing the same thing. And it really drives labor standards and wages downwards if you don't have sufficient enforcement. The other issue that I think that's come up throughout this session is the need for public investment in essential workers and sectors that includes childcare and also long-term care. And, just like it takes roads, right, to get people to work, it actually takes, care at all ends, all parts of the spectrum to get women to work. Because when you don't provide decent, right, affordable care for children and for sick people, for people who are disabled, right, and the elderly, then women get pulled out of the workforce. And we were actually seeing that leading into the COVID recession, which is that there's this gap in women participating because childcare was getting too expensive. And then it really just pushed them over the cliff to have the schools closed. I think an ongoing issue that we've had in the United States that I think this crisis gives us another opportunity to think about is that we have an entire system of critical benefits for workers, like healthcare, like retirement benefits that everybody needs that is really just tied to certain forms of employment. And it's a share of employment that's shrinking, right, as a share of overall employment. And I do think that we need to sort of think about how to have universal access to things like healthcare and retirement, right? That isn't narrowly tied, right, to having a particular kind of job. And so, for instance, in Australia, with their universal retirement account program, basically dependent contractors, right? It's not just bona fide employees, like dependent contractors who primarily work for one company, right? That company is responsible for contributing. And it's like that in other countries. And then finally, I think in thinking about both gig workers and this includes domestic workers, there's like a huge effort among like childcare and home care worker unions to figure out the whole benefits picture. I've seen this go back also with temp workers going back to the 1990s, is that portability is a huge issue, both in terms of coverage, accessibility, and also cost efficiency, right? And so I do think that there needs to be some thinking about how to leverage existing public programs that actually have that built in, right? Have the scale built in, have the have the scope built in to take advantage of that. And also, there are interesting models, right? So in the construction trades, like that's all about gig work, right? You go from job site to job site, right? Contractor to contractor, and your primary association is with the union that then provides you, right? Collects the money from the employers to provide you retirement and health benefits. So I do think that you either have to have some sort of like public sector or associational coverage in order to make these portable benefits work. And I think I'm going to wrap it up right there. Thank you.
All right, thank you all. And as a reminder for the participants, you can type questions into the chat on the NIRS website portal that you joined this meeting through. And I will be happy to read some of those. So first one that we've got is for Kate.
What impact will the provision of federal funds to state and localities have on stemming the employment decline in the public sector? That is from Colleen.
Yeah, so the way the public, like the state and local government works is that they can't run a deficit the same way the federal government can. And so because tax receipts are going to be lower, since incomes are lower, it's going to be harder for them to maintain employment. I mean, it's what we've seen in previous recessions. And so we, without that sustained support, we could see that in the current recession. And even in previous recessions, so the Great Recession was initially called the man session because the first employment losses were for men. But then what we found through the end of the Great Recession and into the recovery, there was these huge impacts on women's employment later on in that recession, partly explained by the decline in public sector work. This recession could risk having that at both ends. Both women lost jobs in some private sector employment, and they could be losing jobs in the public sector if we still allow those losses to go down. That being said, it does seem, at least for now, like that that sort of tide has stemmed a little bit following the passage of the most recent relief package, as well as the reopening a lot of in-person instruction and education.
Yeah, and I know at AFSCME we were very encouraged to see that state and local funding and you know, after the Great Recession, state and local jobs never came back to the level they were. So I think, you know, a couple of you said this, you know, just getting back to where we were pre-pandemic isn't really good enough for anyone for a whole number of reasons. And so hopefully there's some good opportunities as we move forward here for policy that can help people and get us past that austerity.
And Bailey, you also assume the same thing too, that like sometimes too, even if a worker is in one of those great higher quality public sector jobs, if they lose employment and come back, sometimes even unionized employment can be tiered when people are going back into a new position. So they may not be grandfathered into a defined benefit pension plan. So it's really critical to try to keep people in those good jobs rather than have it be really volatile employment.
Yeah. All right, so this is kind of, I think both Kate and Nari touched on this. So there are several commentators I think you're probably familiar with, Kate, to what you were just saying, that this she session, and the disproportionate impact of the school closures on working mothers. Some have, you know, said that it may erase a generation of improvement for women in the workforce. What is the data telling us right now about the possible long-term impacts for women? And again, Kate or Nari or anybody who wants to address that one.
I can actually start. So we've also at the St. Louis Fed done quite a bit of work on the she session. And basically what the data tells us is that women, just like with Hispanic women and Black women, as Kate pointed out, were really disproportionately hit. So typically male-female unemployment rates, they kind of follow each other. But with this pandemic in April, women's unemployment shot up way more than it did men, and it stayed above there for many, many months. Now they're back to similar levels, both elevated compared to a year ago, but similar. But that's deceiving because many women, more women than men, have just dropped out of the labor force entirely. And that's not captured in unemployment rate. Unemployment rates look at people who are actively, at least within the past 4 weeks, looking for work. So if you are a discouraged worker and you say, you know what, it's not worth it to my health or to my family's health for me to be in the labor force right now, or I can't find a job, or I have other care responsibilities to take care of, then they're not going to be captured in those unemployment numbers. So Chair Powell, the head of the Federal Reserve, has said recently that if we were to capture that full aspect of people that have dropped out of the labor force, unemployment rates would be much, much higher than the official reported rates. And you see the same thing for women compared to men, that women's rate year over year would be much higher if we were to capture the full extent that the pandemic has had on them.
Nari, anything to add? It looks like we may have lost Kate, unfortunately, so hopefully she can rejoin us. Okay. All right. Well, again, hopefully Kate will be able to hop back in. So this is again for both of you. So the discussions that will follow this one today are going to focus on policies that are being implemented or still being considered. So I was curious if you could highlight a specific policy or two that you think will have a significant impact on retirement security. And that, again, it could be either be one that's being implemented or one that's being considered, or even if there's one you think should be considered that's not. Oh, good. And Kate made it back. So the same question to you. That's for each of you. If you've got one policy that's either being implemented or being considered that could have a significant impact on retirement security.
So I'll start. Actually, I think it's twofold because at the bottom half, we really have a serious earnings problem, right? We have a serious income distribution problem. So I did a study a couple of years ago that looked at the impact of the what is now the CalSAVERS, used to be Secure Choice, CalSAVERS program combined with a California increase in minimum wage up to $15, then indexed to inflation, right? So it keeps up with the cost of living over time. And so for low-wage workers, for younger low-wage workers, that actually represented something like a 50% bump in the retirement income compared to what they otherwise would have had. So I do think that combining real wage increases with a universal retirement savings program is going to make a huge difference, especially for low-wage workers. So I will stop there.
I can go next, but I might not have a great answer. So I think that's sort of right, that we need to have some sort of universal retirement savings program that would be in addition to Social Security. Thinking a little bit sort of in my area of looking at labor policies, I think the types of policies that give workers better access to unions is also pretty critical to make sure either they have access to unionized retirement security plans or even just that workers have a greater voice in the policymaking process, I think requires some sort of sustained effort to try to give workers more power through institutions like unions. And so that would be something like passing the PRO Act, which is was just introduced in the House recently. It's introduced every year, but maybe there's a chance that I'll make it a little bit further this year than it has previously.
I'll just say that, speaking again for myself and not the Fed, not talking about any specific policy, but there's been a lot of great innovations, I think, in the field. A colleague of mine, Ray Bashara, has looked extensively at 401 kids, or in other words, starting retirement accounts for kids either at birth or a little bit later on, where it would be universal and just built in. And so then it's kind of like a 529 account for education, except for retirement, so not tied obviously to employment because they're kids. But I think there's a lot of bipartisan support for child-based programs. That could potentially have impacts to not just affect retirement broadly, but also racial wealth gaps, educational wealth gaps, generational wealth gaps even. And then the other one I'll mention is just sidecar accounts. So a visiting scholar of ours, Emily Gallagher, has seen that having a small buffer of cash on hand can be more critical to helping families not be completely underwater from an expense, an emergency expense, even above paying for high interest credit card or other debt. And that's kind of surprising to some people. So a sidecar account would basically be an account that is funded by the employer and the employee, from my understanding, which could help them weather a financial crisis so that they don't have to dip into retirement savings, for example.
And one follow-up that came from this discussion for Nari was, what would you suggest in addition to universal retirement and indexed wages on the caregiving side of policy?
Oh, that's a big thing. So I think Ben Vecti is going to be talking about this in Washington State later in the conference. But so I sat on the Master Plan on Aging Research Subcommittee last year in California, and it's a big issue. And unfortunately, the pandemic and the financing piece sort of had to go on the back burner for at least a year, but it is moving forward. So I think on the caregiving piece, it's twofold. It's both access and affordability for families and the wages and working conditions and benefits for caregiver workers. So obviously on the child, because these are very underpaid professions. And also we have this model, for instance, there's the Biden administration is looking at increasing funding for home and community-based care, which is great, right? The need for that was really underscored by the pandemic, and also, seniors and people with disabilities, like that's what they want. So California moved to that model 20 years ago. And one of the fallouts has been that the jobs went from nursing homes, right, employment, often unionized, into these home-based settings. And so wages went down. There are no retirement benefits, no health benefits, right? They've been fighting for health benefits. So that's the issue, is that we need to find a way to pay for it in a way that recognizes the value of the work, right, that care providers provide to families and the overall economy. So I think, the compensation piece is as important as the access piece.
All right, well, unfortunately, we are already at time, which is too bad, because I think this was a really fascinating discussion. All of your presentations were great and provided a lot of good information to think about, especially for those of us in policy advocacy as we move forward and try to create a more equitable future once we hopefully get out of the COVID pandemic. So I wanna thank our three panelists, thank everybody who attended, and again, thank NIRS for bringing us together today to have this important discussion. And I wish you all the best for the rest of the conference as you continue to debate ideas to help people have a more secure retirement. So thank you all again for joining today. We appreciate it.
Thank you.